Monday, so I'm not so tired after a week of pressing that red button in Salem for that much time. So, how do I jam a month of all the drama that's been going on in Salem into 2 minutes? I guess the big thing was Senate Bill 301, the reconnect with the federal government that got right. Dave Hunt's picture in the Oregonian with embarrassment in the headline. The good thing is businesses can now do their taxes, and they could buy equipment on an accelerated depreciation schedule, which is going to get people back to work. So I'm really excited about that. One of my bills, the funeral civility bill, is moving forward. That's the one that establishes
yeah, good
it.
Job.
Thank you very much. That's the one that establishes a 300-foot buffer zone in between protesters and funerals, which I think is an important gesture to make to all Oregonians. So we're going to work hard to keep that going. I had another bill that came before one of my committees in transportation and economic development. And you get a lot of these bills that people refer to as housekeeping bills. Okay, those usually make you raise your eyebrow a little bit higher than anything else. This one happened to be one having to do with vehicle licensing fees. So it got my attention, and it also got the only no vote on the committee. And it was so it is going to go to the floor. It will probably pass, but I stood my ground and I told them why. It allowed for lottery funds to be used. It's for bonding inside of vehicle licensing fees. Anyhow, I voted no, as I've been doing on a whole lot of things. So, holding ground, does anybody have any questions about specific things that you guys want to update on? Or
yes.
All the other seven of them.
I'm going to be doing a very informative newsletter like Richardson does.
Yes, I do that. I do a weekly video address. Best place to find that is on Facebook. Just look up my name on Facebook.
And then, you don't know about that.
All right, well, then go to patricksheehan.org, and there's a link to the legislative update, and you can get all that stuff there as well. Oh, one other thing before I forget, and then I'll grab yours. There's a redistricting meeting. Do you guys know what redistricting is? This is probably the most important political thing that's going to happen here in the next 2 years. And we're having a public hearing on that. I believe it's in April. I sent you
April 9th.
April 9th, okay, at Clackamas Community College from 3 to 6. What we're going to do is we're going to get you guys some information. There's a citizen's guide to redistricting. I sent it to Casey, I think, and I'm sure he can post it to the website so you guys can read what that's all about. The critical thing about redistricting is it's supposed to be fair, and that's all we want. We just want it to be fair. We want people like me to be able to say, I represent Boring, not what street do you live on in Boring, because I only represent one half of it. We need communities to connect, and we need to break away the areas that don't make sense. I have two tiny little precincts in Multnomah County, and tell me what that has to do with anything with Hawksback, Oregon City. Absolutely nothing. So we need your input for those at that event. So hope you guys can all make it. Mark your calendars, and we'll get you more details. And I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, as I understand, there's a bill moving forward on reciprocity of recognition of concealed handgun licenses.
I'm a huge fan of that. Absolutely.
All right, is that moving forward?
Yeah, it's moving forward. And I think they're hearing three or four bills this week having to do with gun rights, and I'm on the right side of all of that.
The CHL right. Privacy is also moving forward.
Right, that's one of the one that's on the same
those
thing.
Two
right,
those are the ones that are moving forward.
Fantastic.
Say what it is.
Oh, it's a
concealed.
To hide the names of people that have concealed handgun licenses from public records.
Good.
The consumer tax on plastic bags.
Plastic bags. It's still in the Senate. They're amending it. It probably won't get out of the Senate. My position is we have much bigger things to be doing than worrying about plastic bags. So stockpile them while you've got them. But I don't think it's going to go anywhere. John.
Patrick, there's a bill moving forward on providing in-state tuition for illegal aliens.
Boom. I'm trying, and I think we will. I don't think there's a whole lot of appetite for spending money, period, let alone for people that haven't been paying into the system. And there is a good argument for why that might be a good idea to get people back into the system and get people not in that cycle of being illegal. It'll help them move forward, but I'm not in favor of that right now. We just don't have the money, and I don't have much of an appetite as you do for putting that forward when we can't educate our own kids.
Patrick, on your time, place, and manner funeral law,
out of the Westboro case, to me, 300 feet's too close. Move those people back 1,000 feet, please.
Yeah, that's the one criticism that everybody has so far, and believe me, we are having bloodbath meetings over this. I'm trying to amend.
We couldn't hear you.
I'm sorry, this is the Westboro Baptist Funeral Civility Act, which has a 300-foot buffer in between protesters and a funeral. And the question was, can we move that to 1,000 feet? We can do anything we want, but we're just trying to keep it to where we have the best chance of it surviving a Supreme Court challenge. And right now, there's even some talk to try to pull out the word picketing from it. I don't want to pull out the word picketing, and I know that's going to be harder to survive that challenge. We're working hard. We had a meeting on Thursday. It was me and Jim Widener, the sponsor of the bill, Chris Garrett, who's a Democrat, who's a lawyer, that had some questions about it, and we sat with two people from legislative council. I had a letter from Jim Huffman. We are really working this thing to try to make sure that it has the best chance, because it's going to court. I mean, it's gonna go to court, so we just want to make sure that it's has the best chance. There's no silver bullet. We can't write the formula to where it's you know, unstoppable. So
on the healthcare issue, there is a proposal to try to limit to seriously reduce what doctors can get for seeing patients. There's already a shortage of doctors that have seen Medicare and worse yet on Medicaid. I understand that that's coming up in, or is it one thing now?
I can check on that. I'm not on the healthcare committee. I deal with transportation, economic development, and consumer protection, general government, and audits. So I can check in on that for you, though, and find out.
Something to do with installing another part of Obamacare, which heavily regulates, cuts the fee so low that doctors can't afford to see the patient.
The lower we cut those fees, the more we're paying in private insurance. And I'm not for that.
Yeah, that was
All right, thanks, Gina.
If you're on an audit committee, have you ever thought of having a performance audit for departments instead of a financial audit? All they do is add up the numbers in a financial audit. We need a performance audit that the money goes where we think it goes and is used correctly.
We do have a couple of bills that have to do with putting it, when money's for like economic development, that it goes into a separate account for economic development so we can see it. There's a transparency website that does that sort of thing. We do have performance audits. And Department of Administrative Services, which is the biggest black hole in government, does performance audits all the time, and they create gigantic spreadsheets and flow charts to show you all sorts of ways that inefficiencies make their way through the system and into your home. So we do performance audits, but the largely it's financial is what we're after. Okay. There was one more.
I just wondered if you could repeat when that redistricting meeting.
I believe it's April 9th from 3 to 6 at Clackamas Community College. We'd really like you guys all to try to make it out for that, because as far as elections go, that is one of the most important things that we're going to have. So we'll get you some information on it, and thank you guys so much. You guys have a great evening.
Thank you, guys. Who here is in District 51, which is Patrick's district? Oregon City, Estacada, Eagle Creek, Damascus, raise your hand. Okay, he's that's why now you know why they named a holiday after him, St. Patrick's Day coming up. Okay, Dan and Tom, come on up here while you're going up. We can't thank you enough for all of you who sacrificed to get those signatures. Boy, I tell you, you guys are you're very, very inspirational. But I'm going to go ahead and let Dan and Tom tell you where we're at.
Where are we at? Oh, we can do it in three, because Patrick took 7 instead of 6. So if you haven't heard, we turned in 7,792 signatures. And 7 days later, they certified our petition to go to the ballot on May 17th. So we will be voting on the voter registration, the vehicle registration being filed. The ballot title will read